Dr. Richard Wolf dropped by today to explain exactly what fractional reserve banking is and why we should care, how it influences and impacts our lives. Check it out, ding the bell, leave your comments, and subscribe to our channel. First, Dr. Richard Wolf is with us here. Dr. Wolf is the author of Capitalism's Crisis Deepens, Essays in the Global Economic Meltdown. He's the co-founder of Democracy at Work, the website democracyatwork.info. His website, his personal website, rdwolf with two Fs, .com. You can tweet him at Prof. Wolf, as in Professor Wolf. Professor Wolf, welcome back.
Thanks. Glad to be here, Tom.
It is great having you with us. I've had a number of people call and ask questions about and try to get their wrap their brains around how our banking system works and why we should care. How does this influence me as just an average workaday person? What does it have to do with things like inflation and unemployment levels and all this kind of stuff? And the starting point seems to be, what is fractional reserve banking and why should I care? How did this come about, even?
Okay, yeah, let's do a little bit the history because it always helps. First of all, we live in a monetized economy. What that means is, instead of me exchanging my shirts for your tomatoes, I sell my shirts for money, and so do you, and I use the money to buy the tomatoes. In other words, money is an intermediary. Money is, if I can say so, what makes the world go around. And it is the thing that you have to be very worried about. Why? Because if there's a scarcity of money, then people can't sell what they need to sell to get it. And then they won't have it. And if they don't have it, well, they can't buy other people's stuff, who then won't have people to sell it to. And it could get very disorganized, the economy, and a lot of people could suffer. In the early days of capitalism, we allowed every bank that wanted to write little IOUs, which we used as money. We did that here in the United States, so that if you traveled more than 5 or 10 miles, you might have to exchange whatever money was floating around where you had started with whatever other money was floating around somewhere else. This was very cumbersome. People didn't want to deal with that. They wanted to have a common currency, something they could use everywhere. So that was solved by having a national currency. But that, too, couldn't be done by private interests, private banks, anybody who could issue a piece of paper saying, I promise to pay. Well, that piece of paper could go from one person to another to pay for things, and that introduced the possibility that people would write these pieces of paper who didn't have anything to back it up, so that if you weren't happy with it, you wanted to cash it in, they smiled at you and said, sorry, we can't handle it. So in the end, make a long story short, in order to have a money supply without which a modern economy can't function, it wasn't safe to allow private interest to do it, so the government took it over. I like to drive that point home so that the silly people who think that there's such a thing as an economy without the government are brought to understand that something as absolutely fundamental as the money supply in every country is a government responsibility in a very large way. Okay, with that as the background, how does the system then work? Basically as follows. We understand that in a modern economy, somebody has to be in charge of the money because it's a universe of its own. And so we allow a kind of partnership. On the one hand, the government that literally prints the money, like those bills that we have in our wallets or the coins in our pockets. So the government is a major player here. But we also allow, in the United States for sure, and in most capitalist countries, we also allow a private banking system. By the way, many countries, they don't even allow only private banks. They have a mixture of government banks and private banks so that the government has even more control. But in the United States, we basically have a private banking system, and so it's a partnership. The best place to see it is in the Federal Reserve, where you literally see, that's the name of our central bank, a kind of partnership between politicians' selections who put them on the board and banks who get together to elect their representatives, and together they manage the money supply. All right, last step to answer the big question you asked. Why does it matter to you and me? Well, here's a simple reason. If the combination, the partnership of the government and the banks pumps too much money into the economy, then there's too much money relative, and all that too much means is relative to the amount of goods and services there are available to buy. If there's too much money, more than the goods and services, then the people with the money bid up the price of goods and services, and we call that an inflation. And if you're a person who hasn't got your hands on the new money coming in, if you're not a big bank or a big corporation or somebody wealthy, well, then a rising price, if your income doesn't go up, is a disaster for you because you can't afford to buy things anymore. So you have a very strong interest in there not being an imbalance between the amount of money looking for goods and services relative to the amount of goods and services that are looking to be sold for money. And the major job of the Federal Reserve, like of central banks in every capitalist country, is to monitor very closely the balance between goods and services on the one hand and money on the other, and try to keep them in a relationship so we don't have a collapse of prices down and we don't have an inflation of prices zooming up. And, you know, in some countries they do that job pretty well. In other countries they don't. They do it sometimes and then out at other times. But it's very urgent for us because we live in an economy where money is the intermediary. It's what we get for the work we do, and it's what we have for the goods and services we want to buy.
Okay, so my understanding is that in a fractional reserve system, that when banks, say a bank has $1 million in reserves, that they can then lend out $9 million based on that because they have to have 10% kept in reserves, and that that additional let's say they can lend out $10 million, the additional $9 million is literally money that has been created into the money supply, the overall money supply. And it would seem that that reserve limit, the government specifying you have to keep a certain amount of money in reserve for your loans, would be one of the ways that the government would regulate how much money can be loaned into existence by the banks. If they increase the reserve limit, it's going to cause the banks to loan less money into existence. If they reduce the reserve limit, they'll loan more money into existence. And that would be one of the ways that they could regulate that. Is that an accurate understanding?
Partly. Let's do it a little bit more slowly. I think you'll get the gist of it. Here's the anxiety. What banks always have done, and they still do it, is they solicit people to give them money, to deposit their personal money, their business money, into the bank. And the reason the bank wants you to do that is they have the right to lend that money out. In other words, they take your deposit and they say, okay, you have an account here. It's worth $10,000, and you can now write checks against it. But while you're doing that, we're going to lend your money out and charge a lot of interest, a lot more than we pay you for putting the deposit in here, which is how we make our money. The federal government steps in and says, well, this is a little scary, because if all the people that are running around writing checks were to do so tomorrow, and the people who they gave the checks to said, okay, pay me to the bank couldn't do it because it just lent out that money in order to make its income. So there's a danger of what used to be called a run on the banks, when the people who put the deposits in want that money out because it's their money. So what the government does is say to the bank, you can't lend out all of the money that depositors give you. You can only lend out a portion. The reserve requirement is simply the phrase that defines what portion of the money deposited in your bank you have to keep back in reserve to cover any risk that people want their money back, so that you can at least cover it. That plus the capital you have that you use to start the bank is the money that a bank uses when there's a run on their assets because, for example, a rumor circulates that the bank is in trouble. That got so bad in American history that we had to create another government agency, the FDIC, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, where the government basically says, in the event that all the depositors want their money back and the bank has lent out so much that it can't get that back from the people it lent to, well, the government will step in and make good to the depositors what the bank itself can't do. That happened in 2008 on a big scale in the United States. The government had to step in and guarantee that the people who had deposited in all the banks in the United States, the big ones that had gone effectively bankrupt, that people wouldn't have to panic because the government would simply step in, print as much money as necessary, and hand it out to all the depositors so they wouldn't be destroyed. So the government steps in, controls the amount you have to hold in reserve, and then crosses its fingers, because even then, if the rumors got bad enough, if enough depositors really got anxious, then even the government's ability to do this would become questionable. And if the government pumped in vast amounts of money, then the anxiety is, in the rush to save the banks, they might put in more, and we get the inflation problem because the extra money pumping in by the government, together with what was already out there, could exceed what it is safe to have in our system. So the game here is to hope, cross your fingers and hope, that the economy doesn't have the kinds of problems that could make people suddenly want to get their hands on money, because if that happens, first the bank and then the government itself might be exposed as unable to solve the problem.